This video is sponsored by ExpressVPN.
So I am in Seattle, Washington, in the downtown bus tunnel, about to hop on a light rail. As a part of a new challenge I've invented for myself, my goal is to ride every single piece of Seattle transit as fast as I can. Now that means regular bus, express bus or rapid ride, streetcar, light rail, commuter rail, monorail, and ferry as fast as I can. So I'm here taking the light rail to Tukwila, and I think it's about to come. So I'll see you on the train.
While I'm getting on this train, let's let me, voiceover Dave, explain the concept of this video in a little more detail. I've identified 7 major modes of transportation, and I'm gonna see how fast I can ride all of them in one outing. It's sort of like speedrunning transit, where the transportation modes are game levels. Here, I'll even add a little progress sidebar so everyone can keep track. The timers are in minutes because this will take a while, and they'll update after I finish that transportation mode, including walking to the next mode. You'll notice that light rail is on there twice because I found out that the fastest way to get from the ferry to the streetcar was another trip on the light rail. I started at 6:37 in the morning, and I'm riding the Link light rail down to Tukwila International Boulevard Station. I'm making this move first because I'm trying to get over to the Sounder for its last run back into downtown for the morning rush. I'll take the Rapid Ride Express bus between the two. That's the first phase of this operation, and it checks off 3 of the 7 transportation modes pretty cleanly. While I'm on the way to Tukwila, let's talk about the Link light rail. Seattle was late to the light rail game. Edmonton built the first North American light rail system in 1978, and other cities followed, including Seattle's neighbor Portland in 1986. In 1996, Seattle voters approved a sales tax to build a light rail system, but the first trains didn't run until 2003. The line I'm riding on, Line 1, didn't open until 2009. Line 1 runs north-south and connects the University of Washington to downtown Seattle and the airport, 3 major regional destinations, and pre-COVID ridership was around 80,000 people per day. Sound Transit, the agency that operates the light rail, plans to expand north to Northgate Transit Center in 2021 and expand to the south by 2024. One aspect of Seattle's transit I'm always surprised by is the lack of high-capacity rail transit, which I consider to be a light rail or a full-on metro system. Portland, Oregon's light rail system has 5 lines, 94 stations, and carries about 120,000 passengers per day. In comparison, Seattle only has 2 lines, 22 stations, and carries 82,000 passengers per day. Yet Portland's metro area population is considerably smaller, 2.7 million to Seattle's 3.9 million. Seattle had a big opportunity to build a real metro system back in the 1960s as a part of a program known as Forward Thrust. In ballot measures, voters passed bond measures for the King Dome Sports Arena, Seattle Aquarium, sewer improvements, and new fire stations, and they passed these all by wide margins. The transit measure, which would have built an impressive metro network, did not reach the 60% threshold to pass, just narrowly receiving only 50%. Had this passed, I would have been riding on a metro system similar to the ones found in Atlanta or Washington, D.C. But here I am on a light rail line heading for the southern suburbs. Let's check in with past Dave to get a review of the train.
So from a rider's perspective, what do I think of the Link light rail system? Now, I've been on a lot of light rail systems in the past, and this one's pretty similar to all the others. It has, it's the typical cars and tracks and stations. I mean, it's not really differentiating itself, but I will say it's nice that it runs separate from traffic in most cases. Right now we're running in the median of an arterial street, but the downtown bus tunnel was nice, and it runs elevated later on in the system. So, you know, it runs on time thanks to that. It's comfortable. It's reasonably nice. I can't complain too much, and I get to ride with this guy right here. So we're having a good time.
All right, very informative, Pass Dave. Now at this point, I'm getting close to Tukwila International Boulevard Station, and I'm a little nervous. The whole plan revolves around making 7 different connections between transit, and I'm trying to go fast and not have long periods waiting for the next train or bus to come. It's also complicated by the fact that I've never been to any of these stations before, and I don't really know where to go when I get off. Luckily, the light rail got into the station at 7:08, right on time, and the Sounder leaves its station at 7:42, meaning I have 34 minutes to wait for the Rapid Ride Express bus, take the bus, and get to the commuter rail station. It should be enough time. And luckily, right when I find the Rapid Ride stop in Tukwila, my bus, the F line, is pulling up for me. I'm immediately no longer worried about making my connection, as everything I've heard about the Rapid Ride told me that it's reliable, fast, and frequent. The website says it comes so often you don't need to even check the timetable. So now I just take my seat and enjoy the ride. So what is the Rapid Ride exactly? It's not quite bus rapid transit, which is generally fast buses running primarily in dedicated lanes. Rapid Ride doesn't have those dedicated lanes for most of its run, but the stop spacing is further than a normal bus. King County Metro, the agency who runs Rapid Ride, implemented traffic signal priority so the buses frequently get green lights. There are 6 lines currently, with more in the works. The lines are popular, carrying about 64,000 passengers per day, not that far from the 82,000 passengers riding the light rail every day. I must say I have a soft spot for express buses. Back when I lived in Portland, I was a regular rider of the 15 express bus running down Belmont in Southeast. It's probably my single favorite transit line of all time, based on nothing but pure homerism and personal experience. Okay, the Rapid Ride trip only lasted 13 minutes, and before I knew it, I was rolling into the Tukwila commuter rail station. Let's go back to past Dave to get a recap on the Rapid Ride bus and a preview of coming transit.
Okay, so I'm off of the Rapid Ride bus. I got here a little bit early because it was so fast, and I'm taking a little mask break outside the station. And I want to give my impressions of the Rapid Ride right after I got off. I didn't get a chance to do it on the bus because it was a pretty quiet bus ride. And I would have felt awkward talking to a camera there. But it was an articulated bus. Felt pretty comfortable. It ran in mixed traffic a lot, but there were a few times when it had its own lane. Stop spacing was pretty good and there was low traffic. So like I said, I got here pretty quickly and now I'm just taking a break. I'm hopping on the Sounder commuter rail next. We're gonna take that right back into the center of the city. I'm looking forward to it. It has a double decker car situation, I believe. So I hope to get a spot on the top and show you around. So, all right, I'm gonna go get into the station and check it out.
Look at me so calm and confident. I'm about to get totally shook up in a second. After wandering around the station a little, I decide it's time to get on the platform with about 3 minutes until the train arrives. I spot the yellow kiosk to scan my fare card only to find out it's gone. I've lost it. And the train is coming in 3 minutes. I'm obviously a terrible vlogger because I didn't film myself sprinting back under the tracks to the ticket vending machines and getting another card. I could hear the train coming as I grabbed the new one and sprinted back to the platform and got on just before the doors closed. It was an incredibly close call. If I had missed this train, I would have been stranded and the whole challenge would have been a failure. This was the last Sounder heading north into downtown until 5:56 in the evening. But luckily I was able to get on the train and I sat down, covered in sweat and rather annoyed by my carelessness. I was particularly frustrated because I had loaded $30 onto that first card and had to load more money onto a new one. At the time, I was convinced that it was somewhere in my pockets or my backpack, but I've since gone through everything and I think somehow I left it on the Rapid Ride. I hope that somebody found it and put the money to good use. This is probably a good time to talk about the card system. In Seattle, the fare card system is called the ORCA card. ORCA stands for One Regional Card for All, and it pretty much does what the name says. You can use it to pay for fares on the light rail, commuter rail, Rapid Ride, the ferries, monorail, streetcar, basically every single kind of transit I had to use that day, so it was really handy. It's really easy to use, just tap inside buses or outside at those yellow card tap kiosks. Despite losing my first card, I give ORCA an A+ for convenience. It's gonna get even more convenient soon when the next gen ORCA card system is released into the wild, probably somewhere around 2023. Word is that it may replicate some of the features of Portland's HOP system, which is a nationwide leader in fare passes. Portland's system allows riders to buy virtual cards and then scan their phone to pay for transit. That would certainly have helped me avoid losing my card. So I was a sweaty mess for much of the 23-minute ride back to Seattle on the Sounder. I was so confident that I would make all of my connections before my close shave. Now I was double-checking my timetables and maps to make sure everything else would go well. There were no stops between Tukwila and King Street Station in Seattle, my final destination. That makes it sort of an express train when compared to the light rail, and it was 8 minutes faster than my ride out to Tukwila on the Link. The trains themselves are double-decker and quite comfortable. Some seats are configured into pods of 4 with a table at the center, which is great for friends and families. It reminded me a little of the Amtrak Capital Corridor line I rode all the time between Sacramento and Berkeley. As I mentioned, this was the last run of this train from Tukwila to Seattle. The Sounder, like many commuter rail lines, has a very limited schedule, which made planning out this speed run a challenge. But I'm sure it's quite useful for those 18,000 daily riders using it for standard AM and PM commutes. The trains run as far south as Tacoma and Lakewood and as far north as Everett. The Amtrak Cascade trains run on the same rails, and monthly Sounder commuter pass holders can use the Cascades like the Sounder between Seattle and Everett. That's pretty cool. My ride on the Sounder went by in a blink, and before I knew it, I was passing the stadiums and coming to a stop at King Street Station. I triple-checked that I had my ORCA card, my phone, and all of my other belongings as I disembarked. I was too flustered to think to stop and look around at the historic station. I really should have. It opened in 1906 and today is served by Amtrak, the Sounder, light rail, streetcar, and buses. I wanted to check out the train halls. They're some of my favorite public spaces in any city, but I followed the crowds out of the station and found myself on the streets of Seattle, pretty far from the station itself.
So I'm off of the Sounder. That was a nice 20-minute trip, and I have about 45 minutes before I need to get on the ferry, so I'm gonna take a quick walk. I can catch the bus later on in my trip, so I'll see you back on the ferry.
That about sums it up. The ferry to Bainbridge Island, the one with the quickest round trip, leaves every 50 minutes. Unfortunately, it's only 8:05 and the ferry leaves at 8:45. So I have 45 minutes to make a 12-minute walk and board the ferry. I walked through the Pioneer Square neighborhood and found myself on Alaskan Way, the topic for another video in this Seattle series. I realized that I needed to get onto the pedestrian overpass a few blocks away, so all told, the walk took me about 15 minutes. I know I told you that the ferry takes Orca cards, but at the time I thought I had to use my Orca card to buy a ferry ticket or something. I really didn't know where to use it. I asked the ticket person, but we couldn't hear each other through the glass with our masks on, so that was really no help. Worried that I missed the ferry despite being insanely early, I bought a ticket separately anyway. Like a sucker. It's what I do to make sure this project stays on track. Finally, it was time to board the ferry and I was quite excited. The weather was absolutely gorgeous in Seattle that day and I was excited to take in the views. The first thing I did on board was get a sense for the ship. There's a lower level with all of the indoor seating as well as an outdoor deck. You can go to the upper deck for somewhat more panoramic outdoor views. Let's take a look at those beautiful views while I talk about the ferries. It's a 35-minute trip each way, so I have a lot of footage. The ferry I'm on is operated by the Washington State Ferries, a state government agency. The ferries are actually considered part of the state highway system. It's no surprise then that they all carry cars as well as people. The scope of the ferry system is pretty amazing. There are 10 lines connecting 20 terminals and 21 boats moving people throughout the Puget Sound. The ferry system carries more passengers than any other ferry system in the United States and the second most in the entire world. Daily ridership pre-COVID was just over 60,000 people per day. The boat I was on, the Tacoma, can carry 2,500 passengers and 202 cars fully loaded, though on my ride there was maybe 75 passengers. Not a lot of people heading to Bainbridge Island at 8:45 on a Tuesday, I guess. On my way to Bainbridge Island, you can get a good view of the Port of Seattle, other ferries, and the city of Seattle itself. I think you'd get better views of the city during sunset when it isn't backlit. Still, it's a pretty great view. Passengers can even see wildlife on the boat, though I didn't see anything besides the occasional gull. People luckier than me have seen harbor seals, sea lions, otters, dolphins, whales, and orcas. 35 minutes went by in a blink, and it was time for me to leave the boat, turn back around, and get on it again. Before I did, I found a good spot to watch the boat dock and the pedestrian bridge come down. It's obvious that this process is done so often it's like a science and probably boring to the ferry staff, but it was still fun for me to watch. I took my time getting off the ferry because I knew they had to take some time to unload all of the cars and prep the boat for the return journey. I spent a few unremarkable minutes in the Bainbridge Island ferry terminal before turning right back around and getting in line to get back on. I watched the cars get loaded onto the ferry, something I missed on my way here, paid my respects to the harbor masters, and got ready for the return journey. By this point in my speedrun, I was getting a little hungry. I had a granola bar in my hotel room at like 6 in the morning, and over 3 hours later, I was hoping for a snack. I realized that I hadn't packed anything to eat, which was obviously a big mistake, but I got really excited to use the onboard cafe, which I had heard about but didn't visit during my trip to Bainbridge. But I was super disappointed to find out that it's closed due to COVID. To make matters worse, they were servicing the vending machines at the exact same time, meaning I wouldn't get a chance to eat until after the speedrun was complete. I survived, but just barely. Kidding, that was a little dramatic. So as I approached Seattle, I got a little reflective. What did I think of the trip?
Okay, we're just about to get into Seattle here on the ferry, and you know, what can I say? It's an amazing piece of transit. The views are unbeatable. It's super comfortable. There's a cafe down there. I can see how transit riders who take this daily could get a lot of work done here. It's also just one of those pieces of transit that's iconic. And if you're in Seattle, take a ride, even if you don't need to commute on it, just like I'm doing right now. It's phenomenal. So, like I said, just about to disembark and get on our next piece of transit.
Well said as always, Past Dave. Just like on the way there, I filmed the boat docking and lowering to the pedestrian gangway. It's just one of the coolest parts of the trip for me, so I'm making you watch the process again. Sorry about that. So now it's 10:15 and I'm leaving the ferry terminal. After another walk through the southern edge of downtown Seattle, I make it back to the Pioneer Square light rail station, the exact same place where I started this journey. Though this time, I'm on the other side of the platform. Luckily, I don't have to wait long before catching a northbound train. It's a relatively quick trip, only two short stops. This segment makes it feel like Seattle almost has a metro system, as it runs entirely underground here, through the downtown Seattle Transit Tunnel. This tunnel is actually sometimes known to locals as the bus tunnel. That's because from 1990, when it opened, until 2005, buses were the only vehicles in it. The tunnel was designed with a possibility of accommodating light rail later, and in 2009, the tunnel began to host both modes. Here's a picture of what that looked like. It's kind of strange seeing a bus in a tunnel next to a train. It's like it got lost or something. After 10 years of sharing, the tunnel is now light rail only, with buses back up on the surface streets. King County Metro had operated the tunnel, but control was transferred to Sound Transit. As far as tunnels go, it's not that long. It's 1.3 miles from end to end, with four stations open right now. Seattle's expanding its convention center, and when it finishes, the convention center station will reopen. Okay, enough tunnel talk. I'm at my station, Westlake, Seattle. The station is embedded below a downtown shopping center, and I'll be seeing it again at the end of this video. But for now, it's a quick walk to the streetcar for a brief trip north. This line is the South Lake Union Streetcar, Seattle's first of two modern streetcar lines. It opened in 2007 and connects downtown Seattle to the South Lake Union neighborhood. That area used to be a sleepy warehouse district, but is now home to Amazon's largest campus and a lot of new development. Billionaire Paul Allen contributed half of the funding necessary for the streetcar, as his company, Vulcan Real Estate, planned on building some of the aforementioned new development. Modern streetcars are often used as tools for redevelopment and gentrification. This streetcar, like other modern streetcars around the US, are quite slow and not great pieces of transit. Seattle now has buses along this corridor that will get you to where you're going just as fast. Sometimes walking can be faster. I only took the streetcar for two stops, from Westlake Hub to Westlake and 9th Denny. From here, it was a short walk to the next transit mode, the regular old city bus. I actually made a mistake here and didn't walk to the stop closest to the streetcar, but instead walked along the bus line for a few blocks before finding a stop. Here's what I had to say when I did find the bus stop.
Okay, I'm at the bus stop waiting for the number 8 bus. This will be my second to last piece of transit before I get on the monorail here and finish this whole thing up. Now, this is also the shortest trip I'm gonna take. I'm only gonna take this bus one stop. The monorail, I can see the monorail tracks behind me. Like, I could probably walk there faster than waiting for this bus, but it must be done. I must ride this last piece of transit before the monorail to complete my mission.
With only one stop on the bus, I don't have a lot of time to talk about Seattle's bus system. The bus system is operated by King County Metro, the same agency that runs the Rapid Ride and Streetcar. The system carries about 400,000 passengers per day in a non-COVID year. That number is over 3 times more than the light rail and way higher than any other mode of transit in the city. In Seattle, just like most US cities, the local bus system is the true transit backbone. They're not as sexy as a train or ferry, but buses get the job done. The number 8 bus is a crosstown route that starts near Seattle Center, home of the Space Needle, before moving across the Capitol Hill neighborhood and then heading down to the Mount Baker Transit Center. It's one of the busiest lines in the system. Before I knew it, I could spy the Space Needle out the window, which meant I was very close to my stop. I disembarked from the back and started walking towards Seattle Center. This meant I was truly on the home stretch, only one more type of transit to go. Let's take a look at the map to see how far we've come. I started at Pioneer Square Station, took the light rail to Tukwila, got on the rapid ride to the Sounder, lost my Metro card, and still took the Sounder to the King Street Station. I got off there, walked to the ferry, and rode the ferry to and from Bainbridge Island. I hopped back on the light rail to Westlake, got on the streetcar, and transferred to the bus. At this point, it's about 10:55 in the morning, and I'm hustling to get to the monorail. The monorail schedule was one of the biggest challenges to my overall schedule. It doesn't start running until 11 a.m., which means any morning attempt to speedrun Seattle will have to end with the monorail. I'm hurrying through Seattle Center and past the Space Needle to get to the first run of the monorail right at 11 a.m. I get in line at about 1 minute to 11 and hope they sell me a ticket before they leave the station. The monorail, like everything else on this trip, takes my Orca card and they let me get on the first train, which leaves maybe a minute after 11. The first thing you notice about the monorail is how old it is. This is one of the two original trains that have been in operation since 1962, the year of Seattle's Century 21 World's Fair, the reason the city has its iconic Space Needle. The monorail carried and still carries passengers from downtown to Seattle Center. There have been several attempts to expand the monorail beyond its 1 mile, two station route. The original 1960s vision had the monorail going as far south as the airport. Another effort to expand the monorail in the late 90s and 2000s flamed out. Regional rail in Seattle is now the sole domain of the light rail. I've been asked to do a video on monorails for almost as long as I've had a channel, and I'm not saying I won't, But riding this monorail is not inspiring me to make one. Monorails aren't all that different from other elevated rail systems. They're a little quieter, I guess, but this one in particular is incredibly bumpy. I think the bus was a smoother ride than this. Coupled with the outdated train itself, and this didn't feel like a very special piece of transit. I mean, there's a certain vintage feel to the train, and the windows are pretty awesome, but it reminds me more of a historic streetcar line than a modern transit line. And when you look at the schedule and its opening time of 11 o'clock, it's obvious that it's meant to be a tourist attraction and not a serious piece of transit. But hey, I committed to ride all of the transit in Seattle, tourist or not, and as I rolled into the under-construction station at Westlake, I had finally done it. 7 modes in one long morning. I'll send it back to Past Dave for the recap.
Okay, it's 11:08 a.m., and I just finished my 4-minute monorail ride back into downtown Seattle, and I did it. I have ridden all 7 major kinds of transit in Seattle, with the monorail being the last one right overhead. It's been a whirlwind tour of Seattle for sure. I'm not sure I'd recommend it to everyone who is here as a tourist. Tukwila is nice, but maybe not worth a stop on the light rail and then back on the Sounder. But overall, it was a great way to experience all that Seattle has to offer in terms of transit, and it was a great trip. Thanks for watching.
Hey, so I'm back from my epic transit trip, and I'm taking a moment here in the hotel to back up all my files and do a little web browsing. And when I travel, I like to make sure that I'm staying secure. Now, I'm hooked up to a hotel Wi-Fi. It's unsecured. So when I do stuff like that, I like to use ExpressVPN to make sure my browsing is encrypted and protected.
It's so easy to use. You just open the app, choose your location, click one button, and you're ready to go. Your browsing is safe and secure.
And when I'm traveling like this, I'm always backing up data to the cloud, and ExpressVPN does not slow me down. I can't say the same thing for hotel Wi-Fi, but what can you do? I've also used ExpressVPN to help me download files for my videos via torrent when my ISP tried to stop me. You can use ExpressVPN to hide that activity. It's very handy. In fact, I was making my Parks and Rec video and downloaded ExpressVPN to get around my ISP over a year ago, way before I was sponsored. I looked at the competition and decided ExpressVPN was the best, and it hasn't let me down yet. It's always great to get sponsored by a product you already use and love.
To find out how you can get 3 months of free ExpressVPN access, go click on the link in the description below. That's expressvpn.com/citybeautiful.